Good afternoon, everybody. We are into the fourth session in Hall A, Video Assisted Skill Transfer 2. I think the first speaker is Ravi Krishna. If he is there or his videos are there. Madam, his videos are there?
Jyoti? No, doctor. Dr. Ravi Krishna video is not there. Dr. Ram Krishna video is there.
Okay. Shall we go ahead with the second Ram Krishna sir? Satyamurthy sir? Unmute, sir. Unmute.
Yeah, we can start with.
Yeah. You can play, madam.
Sir, I would like to thank you all for giving me this opportunity to present my technique of FECO in intumescent cataract to avoid Argentinian flag sign, which I call it as the Tadinki technique. I have absolutely no financial in this one. And what is this Tadinki technique? Tadinki technique is a way to avoid the Argentinian flag sign. I have tried all means like FECO punch, double rexis, aspirating the sharp needle, spiral rexis, etc. This is one more weapon in the armamentarium, but a better and a more predictable way of avoiding the Argentina flag sign. The advantage of this technique is that one can use their existing FECO machine. The reason for using the FECO handpiece is that the larger bore aspirates the gel-like liquefied cortex very easily. Syringes fail to aspirate the cortex as it is thick and not so easy to aspirate. So I have enumerated all the steps from step 1 to step 5. The step 1, with the right hand, one holds the FECO handpiece in the IA mode. And with the left hand, one holds the cystic tube. So the step number 2, initiate high vacuum before puncturing the anterior capsule. The step number 3, make a nick under high aspiration. Advantage is that it instantly aspirates and decompresses the lens. And step number 4, fill the anterior chamber with visco before the handpiece removal. This is a very important point because if you suddenly remove the FECO handpiece, it can propagate the capsular break to the periphery. Avoid sudden decompression of the anticapsule. Never overfill because the risk of reverse Argentine flag sign is very high. Step number 5, proceed with the surgery as usual. So as usual, I make the side ports. I am operating this case under topical anesthesia. And then I inject platinum blue into the anterior chamber, left there for a few seconds and washed off. And the anterior chamber is filled with visco and HPMC. In all these cases with hard cataracts, I always use visco, even though I don't have any financial interest here. I stabilize the eye with Sinsky, and then the main entry tunnel is made with the 2.8 keratome. Now, the eye is stabilized with the Sinsky hook, and the FECO handpiece is inserted in the IA mode. Then the Sinsky hook is removed, and then the cystitome is inserted through the side port. Now, high vacuum is initiated. One can see the fluid currents there, and then the anticapsule is punctured with the cystitome. One can see that the FECO handpiece instantly aspirates the leaking particle matter. The same thing I'll be showing in high magnification, slow motion as well, for you to understand clearly. Now, the leaking cortical matter is aspirated, and then the cystitome is removed. The FECO handpiece is not removed here. Only the cystitome is removed and the anterior chamber is reformed with the viscoelastic before the FECO handpiece removal. This is very important to avoid the capsular break running to the periphery. Now it is rexis as usual. The leading edge is propagated in a curvilinear fashion and then the rexis is made. So after making the rexis, I top up the anterior chamber with visco and HPMC, and then it is FECO as usual. So I remove all the loose cortical matter. In all these cases with dense hard nuclei, I always use my technique of modulating the FECO power. If modulating the FECO power means I use a high vacuum with a moderate power. The reason is that the high vacuum decreases the need for higher energy to emulsify the nucleus. So in my Venturi machine, the high vacuum, I go up to around 250 to 280 millimeters of mercury. Now I make the nucleus in two halves, and depending upon the requirement, I make it into 4 or 8. It depends upon the density of the cataract. So I'm making it into 4 quadrants. The nucleus is pretty leathery, quite difficult to crack. And then I start sub-chopping. So each piece is pulled up and emulsified in the iris plane. So it's a good idea to top up the anterior chamber with viscoat in between to have a crystal clear cornea in the postoperative period. So all the four quadrants are emulsified. I'm showing the cortex wash in fast forward motion. All the cortex is removed with a bit of a difficulty. And whatever cortex that is adherent to the Purslane capsule is flushed with saline. Now the minimal cortical strands are removed. And then I fill the anterior chamber with HPMC before injecting the lens. So the lens is dialed into the bag. So at the end of the surgery, the cornea looks crystal clear. The take-home point for Tarenki technique is that there's no technique in the world which is 100% safe and accurate in intumescent cataract for avoiding Argentinian flags. My technique does well because the phaco handpiece in IM mode pressurizes the anterior chamber and instantly aspirates the leaking cortex, thereby minimizing the risk of Argentinian flags. Thank you very much.
Nice, very nice. Sir is a practitioner in Guntur. He is not there in the panel, I think. He has sent the video. Sir, any comments, sir? Rini, sir, Satyamurthy, sir.
Yeah. I'm not sure if this technique will work in my hands because, see, the issue with these intermittent cataracts is that, see, you have a high intralenticular pressure, not just in front. Behind is there everywhere, and with this, see, you make one nick and it'll run off. What whichever has to run off, it is going to run off. So you make one nick and you have to time the vacuum in such a way that as soon as it comes and you go inside and aspirate, it's not going to work in my hand. My work in his hand and other hands. So, see, as I said, no technique is perfect. Probably the simplest one is the needle aspiration, making sure that, see, sometimes the problem what happens is that the nurse gives you the cystotome with a filled 2C syringe. You might not have enough space to actually aspirate. So make sure that it's just half or one third filled and just go in and aspirate. It works. It works. I've tried the phaco puncture this thing and all, but I feel the safest and most uncomplicated one is the aspiration with the 26G needle. That's it's not at all. It doesn't make anything confusing at all. And you aspirate in front, press the nucleus a bit, and then aspirate again so that that retrolenticular pressure, that fluid also comes off, then it comes up in whichever is meant to go, is going to go, whatever. And see, what we have seen is that in these particular cases, it runs off to the periphery and you do an extra RXS or even convert it into can opener and complete it. Almost 100% of the cases, you don't get a PCR. It's unlike it running off to the periphery while you're doing a RXS in a normal case. Here, you can actually complete the phaco safely and make sure that the haptics are oriented in the direction 90 degree opposite to where it has run off.
Phaco done outside innovation. The back.
Pardon, sir?
Phaco done outside the back, not inside.
No, you can do it inside the bag also. That's why, like, initially and all, when this used to happen, I used to either convert to SICS or, as you said, do it in the supracapsular space. But somehow it doesn't run out to the but as you said, it might be a good idea to do it in the supracapsular this thing. But the problem is you take it out. See, there is another issue here. You're bringing the nucleus out. That itself can, if that has to run off to the PC, that itself can run it off. But it works. I mean, it's a safe surgery in engineering blood.
Sir,
Dr. Ravi, see, what I feel here is the stability of antichamber. Antichamber should remain stable. In fact, you have been using Acimenter for quite some time now in FACO. So you must have done in intermittent cataracts also.
Yes.
Isn't it?
Yes, sir.
So what Dr. Ramakrishna showed, that is basically the stable antichamber, which, otherwise, it's just a vacuum. And if there's mismatch between vacuum and irrigation, then again, it's going to. Okay. So it's a good technique, no doubt. But I mean, it's one of the ways of. Yes, exactly. One of the ways. And I want to know from you, your experience, because you have been using Acimenter in almost every case, isn't it?
So, in all the intumescent and hypermature cataracts, my initial is 1 lick, then Acimenter is flowing, the fluid is flowing, I press the lip of the posterior, this thing, the fluid comes out. And again, I make a small recess. Then I cut it and extend it. That is the standard.
So, intermittent cataract, never had any runoff.
I have split it. No, sir. I had a runoff, recess runoff. But nowadays, I am doing small opening. Then, a small amount of fluid is enough to take care of all that the pressure equalization.
No, correct. But Acimenter, does it help to prevent this?
Yes, sir, definitely. Acimenter is a tremendous help. There is no time. Otherwise, I have the video. It is very, very helpful, sir. All the time, you don't need not have to think about that follow and all. You just aspirate, and then same sitting, you can do the rest. Same needle.
Right.
I aspirate from the same side port. Yes,
correct. You're right.
Can we go ahead with the Sheetal Ballal, madam?
Yes.
Dr. Sheetal?
Yes, sir. I'm here.
Dr. Sheetal, a practitioner in Bangalore. Please go ahead with your practice.
Good evening. I'm Dr. Sheetal Ballal from Manipal Hospital, Bangalore. At the outset, I would like to thank Dr. Ilan Kumar and the Managing Committee of the Karnataka Ophthalmic Society for giving me this opportunity. My talk is on PCR management, and I would be talking about the common mistakes made during PCR management and the correct strategy to manage such cases.
For any cataract surgeon, a posterior capsular rent is the commonest and most feared complication one encounters. If the strategy is very clear, these cases can be managed well without compromising the result and can end up as any other uncomplicated case. Hence, it is imperative to have a proper strategy to manage such eventualities. So, coming to our case, it was a routine case which was going as planned. The chalk fragments are gradually emulsified one by one. At this stage, a rent has occurred. However, the surgeon fails to recognize it. And this is the first mistake, that is not recognizing the rent as soon as it occurs. Early identification of the rent can be a game changer because it prevents its extension and limits the damage. So prophylactic measures can be used promptly to prevent the expansion of the tear and a nucleus drop or a vitreous prolapse. There are certain telltale signs which need to be looked out for. Like in this case, the fragment is not coming very easily towards the phaco tip and the emulsification is not very smooth. However, it continues and the rent has increased in size as would be expected. The second mistake is to remove the phaco probe suddenly from the eye. Once a rent is seen, the general reaction is to panic and suddenly remove the phaco probe from the eye. This can be disastrous and should be avoided because it causes a sudden collapse of the anterior chamber and rapid enlargement of the tear with vitreous prolapse. Instead, the phaco should be kept in foot position 1, and through the side port, a dispersive OVD should be injected to stabilize the fragments before removing the phaco probe. So here it is done later on. Now the OVD is being injected. The next step is to do a complete and thorough vitrectomy. For this, it is useful to use triamcinolone, diluted triamcinolone injected into the anterior chamber, because this gets impregnated into the vitreous strands and makes recognition of the strands which have prolapsed into the anterior chamber much more simple and easy as compared to trying to visualize it without the use of triamcinolone. So here the vitrectomy is being done, and now we can see that there was a fragment which has gone posteriorly, which is dancing around the vitrectomy probe. So it comes towards the vitrectomy probe and again goes behind. So here viscoelastic is being injected and a phaco probe is being used to remove this fragment. This is something which should be completely avoided. If there is any fragment which is tilting or descending, one should be very careful never to try to fish it out using a phaco probe. So the nucleus instead can be successfully maneuvered by using an OVD, which can be brought up gradually using a visco levitation, or it can be guided using a hoop to bring it more anteriorly and then very safely emulsified. Alternately, an IOL scaffold can be used beneath this fragment in order to ensure that it doesn't go posteriorly. After this fragment is removed, in this case, dry aspiration is being rightly done. So here OVD is injected into the anterior chamber, and then only using aspiration, the cortical matter is held at the periphery and gradually pulled in a tangential manner towards the center. The cortex away from the rent is aspirated first, while the cortex adjacent to the rent is manipulated in the end and very gently. Once the cortex is completely removed, here an iris repositor is used to confirm the absence of vitreous strands in the anterior chamber. Again, instead of this manipulation, it is better to use triamcinolone for identifying the vitreous strands without undue movement of the vitreous which has prolapsed into the anterior chamber. So here the vitrectomy is again being done to ensure complete removal of all the vitreous strands before placing the intraocular lens. The IOL can be planned according to the size of the rent. As the rent in this case is large, a three-piece IOL is being injected into the anterior chamber, and the haptics are then very gently tucked just behind the iris in the sulcus. Care should be taken to always place only a three-piece IOL in the sulcus. Never place a single-piece hydrophobic IOL as it leads to constant irritation of the iris and chronic uveitis. If the rexus is around 5 to 5.5 millimeter, an optic capture can be done to ensure that the IOL is very stable and does not get decentered in the future. If the rexus is bigger, then optic capture is difficult. So this three-piece IOL can just be placed in the sulcus by reducing its power by around 0.5 diopters or 5% reduction. Once the IOL is placed in the sulcus and its stability ensured, the viscoelastics which are there in the anterior chamber are very gently washed and the AC is formed before closing the case. A single suture may be placed in order to ensure that the AC is well formed and there is no leak. After this is done, the side ports are hydrated. So this is the end of the case. Though the results were good, the few mistakes which happened and which are quite common could well have been avoided. So our goal in management of PCR includes prevention of extension of the tear, preserving adequate support for IOL placement, and protecting the corneal endothelium. So the strategy includes early diagnosis, where subtle changes in AC dynamics should be looked for, the generous use of a dispersive OVD to tamponade the tear and maintain anterior chamber at every step every time the instruments are removed from the eye. Once a rent has occurred, it is important to pause and to assess the situation. And further plan depends on the stage of the surgery as well as the size of the nucleus which remains. If it is a large nuclear fragment, it is wise to convert to a small incision cataract surgery. On the other end, if it is a very small rent and which has occurred at the end of the surgery, it can be converted to a posterior capsular rexus and an IOL placed in the back. A transsphenoid assisted vitrectomy is useful to ensure that the vitreous strands are completely removed from the anterior chamber before proceeding. Dry aspiration of the cortex should always be done, and placement of the IOL in the sulcus should always be with a three-piece IOL, and as far as possible an optic capture should be done to ensure the long-term stability. To conclude, incidence of PCR can be decreased significantly by identifying the presence of predisposing factors and appropriate modification of the plan, and early recognition of a rent with prompt management of a capsular tear and vitreous prolapse is the key to a good post-op outcome in such cases. Thank you.
Any comment, or shall we go with the next? Mine is the next one.
Very lucky, surgeon.
Madam, do you advocate iridectomy still in all the cases of rent with even after doing proper iridectomy?
Iridectomy, sir. A peripheral iridectomy. Not necessary if the vitreous has been completely ensured that you have removed the vitreous completely. So. Not really mandatory in all cases.
And have you, I have put a few of single piece lenses in the sulcus. I think, I'm sure you must have also put, have you encountered major problems with those?
Sir, we do see some cases who end up. So I think as far as possible, definitely the chronic uveitis is an issue. So if, especially if it is a planned surgery where you can expect a complication, then keeping a three-piece standby is always important. And if at all it comes to that, then even a rigid lens is preferable rather than placing a hydrophobic, because they're bulky lenses. They do have a high chance of causing complications. So we have seen cases where we had to explant it and then place a three-piece in the sulcus.
What was the reason for explantation? Uveitis or glaucoma?
Sir, chronic uveitis leading to glaucoma. So it becomes difficult to manage in some of these cases, as no matter how much you increase the medications, especially steroid responders, you increase the steroids, then the glaucoma is a little difficult to manage.
Many of these cases, even if you exchange the lens also, you might have to do trabeculectomy to control the intraocular pressure in those cases. You don't, if the IOP stays under control for about 3-4 months, even if the trap fails after that, but you definitely, in many cases in which the single pieces intraocular lenses have been placed in the sulcus, it is an issue. Basically, it is because of the square edge design of the haptic. That is what it's rubbing on the thing. So, as Dr. Sridhar said, as far as possible, it should be a three-piece IOL or a PMML lens. PMML lens also works absolutely. So one question, Dr. Sheetal, do you routinely use moxifloxacin intracameral for all your cases or just for PCR cases? You didn't mention about...
Yes, we routinely use for all our cases.
Okay, I don't, but for those cases with PCR, definitely I give moxifloxacin.
We'll go ahead with the next question, sir. Thank you. Thank you, Sheetal.
Yes, sir.
Next is mine. I'll share my screen. Sir, is my screen visible?
Yeah.
Sir. Is it visible,
yeah.
sir?
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah, yeah. yeah.
Okay. Namaste, everybody. My topic is epinucleus and fiber removal. At the end of the emulsification of the nucleus, the AC maintainer is introduced in the opposite quadrant of the main tunnel, and the secondary hydro dissection like thing is done with a 10 ml syringe PSS injected inside the eye, something like doing once again hydro dissection. The bulky epinucleus is coming out very easily, and remaining epinucleus is aspirated manually. This is a 23 gauge cannula mounted on the 2 ml glass syringe for smooth taking out the epinucleus. In from one single side port, you can remove it completely. This is one more case. The hydro-like procedure is done. Along with that, I am pressing the posterior lip. The whole of the bulky epinucleus sac comes out, and remaining epinucleus is aspirated from the side port. Depending on the bulkiness of the epinucleus, I prefer to use either 23 or 24 cannulas. And the bottom height is around 80 to 90 centimeters of the AC maintainer. The fibers attached are also washed away with a jet of BSS tangentially going inside. Complete thorough wash is given. One more case. Due to the high pressure in the anterior chamber, aggressive type of system, everything comes out. And the remaining epinucleus is aspirated manually. I use simple 23-24 cannulas. They are very cost effective compared to the bimanual. Maintenance is also very easy. Once they are blocked, repeated blocking, you can throw it away and take one more testing. This is about epinucleus. Coming to the fiber removal, I have this unique type of technique wherein I can completely remove the epinucleus, meaning fiber. This is the initial jet of VSS given, and I use 24 cannula mounted on 2 ml glass syringe. Plunger is removed. There is no plunger in it. It is an empty syringe and 24 cannula there. And I go near the posterior capsule, the raised margin of this flask. You just go near that, it starts going inside. Due to the high pressure in the anterior chamber from the anterior chamber maintainer, the gush of BSS tries to escape from the anterior chamber because of the negative pressure in the empty syringe. There is no plunger on the syringe. The fluid escapes out passively, you can say. Complete posterior capsule polishing can be done safely. This is a very safe technique, even though sometimes PC appears to come on to the port, just you can see it here in this video. It comes onto the port, but I have hardly damaged the posterior capsule in this procedure. However, you should have a very good quality cannula. Inspect them under the microscope before doing this procedure. I use sandblasted good quality cannula. If they are ragged, if they have a rag, like this, discard them and take the new one. This is a 24 cannula, and the plunger is removed, piston is removed, and the globe is stabilized with a non-traumatic Hosking or Colibri. And just go inside, go near the posterior capsule, raise it. You can see the posterior capsule coming onto the port, but it never gets damaged. VSF is flowing and it is taking away all the epinucleus or the fibers attached to the posterior capsule. In fact, I have started trying it with a soft tip flute. I have tried in few cases. I'll present it to you in the next conference, I think. This is how safely it is done. It's a very safe technique. Thank you very much. Thank you, sir. I'm done.
Hello. Ravi, very nice technique. Just say, I want to know, why did you start with ACM interaction in FECO?
I was doing SITS basically under AC maintainer. When I switched to FECO, the initial part Rexis used to be very easy in under AC maintainer because Visco used to escape from the this thing and the entry capsule used to become convex. So in the AC maintainer, all the time it is flat, Rexis used to be very easy. So that way I continued for the rest of the FECO, and while removing the epinucleus, it's damn easy. I have burnt my hands by doing it in bimanuals. Costly bimanuals are lost or damaged because of the man handling. While washing and all, people used to destroy them. They used to be very costly. And small practitioners like me, I can save money in some of these things. So I resorted to this, and this works beautiful for me.
No, that's fine. All your cases I saw, AC maintainer, it was facing up, facing the cornea. Don't you think facing this thing down, bevel down, you can protect the endothelium that way?
Yes, that is there, sir. Instead of down or up, if it is facing towards your hand,
towards
that is ideal, sir. Few of the cases I do like that also. But I have not done any specular microscopy or anything like that for these cases. But yes, as you said, it has a point. It can damage.
And primary fibrosis is all the plaques, fibrotic plaques will also come like this with your
canal. Not all the plaques. Some plaques are left. Yeah,
you cannot have it. The same micro explosives with the AC maintainer. Does it work that way?
No, sir. I am not right. I have seen a Deepak Mehta doing it with Rexis process, actually feeling it, but I have not tried it. I think we should try it.
Right.
It should work, sir. It should work.
No, very nice technique. Excellent.
Thank you. Excellent technique, Dr. Ravi. I've never tried AC maintenance ever in my life, but this looked beautiful. How did you get the idea that you don't use a plunger and you just keep the cannula there, everything will come? That was really good.
I saw some technique wherein the passive fluid comes due to negative pressure. And just I tried once, it came out very nicely. Since last 2 months, I am trying with a soft fluid. I bought it and I bent it like this and using it, polishing it, literally polishing the posterior capsule. It's very safe. I think I'll have 10-15 cases, then I'll put it.
Yeah, good.
Thank you, sir. Shall we go ahead with the next speaker, sir?
Dr. Divyansh is here.
Dr. Divyansh is ready. Then, sir, Dr. Timothy.
Good evening, sir. Good evening. Yeah, I think my talk is already recorded. Can the tech team play? Thank you for the opportunity, sir. I am actually attending a simultaneous other session also. Sure. I'm there, but don't worry. Yeah.
Good evening, all. Thank you, COSCON. Thank you, Dr. Ellen, sir. So my topic for today is IOL options in absence of bag. And my choice would be a modified Yamani technique. So the overview of presentation is, one, most important, the case selection for such scenarios, the IOL selection, needle selections, heat cautery, which is important for making the flanges, and technique of intrascleral haptic fixated IOL, either Yamane or our own modifications, and some case scenarios. So most importantly, the case selections are the cases where the pupil is very widely dilated because of traumatic mydriasis. IOL options, the first and foremost is a Technis three-piece IOL or an Avency COA lens, which is again a three-piece, or a very cheap alternative XL lens that is not very easily available at this point, that is also a three-piece IOL. Needle options, 26, 27 or 30 gauge BD needles can be used, but wide inner bore needles where the innermost diameter is wider. Heat cautery, Bovi is a commonest heat cautery which is available and very easily available on Amazon or eBay. Coming to the case scenario, so this is a case of post-trauma where the lens is partly subluxated with a very dense cataract, as you can see, that has been removed in toto, and then an anterovitrectomy is done, marking the axis and then loading the leading haptic of the IOL, and then bovicauterizing it, and then making a bulb at the end. Again, re-identifying the center, and then passing the trailing haptic. In this case, as what we can see is the exteriorization of the needle, where easily the lens haptic can be pushed into the needle and railroaded back. And then the IOL is well set, as we can see with the flanges in place. In this case, the iris also had an inferior defect, so a pupilloplasty can be done. This is the next case, as what we can see. Patient had a temporal SICS wound, so switching on to the nasal side infusion, and then marking the first markings, which are at the limbus, and the second marking is parallel to the limbus, which creates a little small scleral tunnel. And this is how a tunnel is made, and the leading haptic can directly be pushed into needle and then taken out. Always confirm the size of the bovi utilizing the needle. External diameter is little more. Again, markings are very important, where we mark the first 2 mm from the limbus and then 2 mm scleral tunnel, which is parallel to the limbus. In this case, as you can see, you can do an internal maneuvering also using a 23 gauge forceps. And once the haptic is out, then make a small bovi, reconfirm the size, and then push it back into the scleral space or the subconjunctival space. And you can continue with the vitrectomy surgery. This is another case number 3, where there is a subluxation of lens inside the eye. So the vitreous is completely cleared around the lens. And once the lens is completely free of the vitreous, then it can be the scleral tunnel can be opened, a visco can be injected into the anterior chamber, and then the lens can be held from the haptic optic junction, and the biome can be removed, and we can see that the lens can be easily delivered out of the eye after plugging the ports. In this case, we are utilizing an iris repositor, so I had to counteract the simultaneous rotation of the lens into the anterior chamber, and then visco is injected, and then it is taken out using a MacPherson force. In this case, the patient also had diabetic macular edema with ERM, so that was the reason we had planned for an SFIL and not an iris claw. And after correctly marking the port sites, the SFIL can easily be done. But yes, always reconfirm the size of the bovi, because that is the most common cause of subluxation. Easily, the vitrectomy can be performed, laser fluid exchange can also be performed. In certain cases, there can be slippage of the flange or the haptic. As we can see, one side of the haptic is very well seen in the scleral tunnel and the other side is completely empty. So in such cases, what you would see is something like this, where the IOL is partly hanging into the pupillary axis or into the anterior vitreous, where we can reposition it. Usually this 26 needle would not work because there is already a flange. So what we can do is make a 26 gauge entry and pass a 25 gauge forceps through it. And then you can hold the bulb and then pull it out of the eye. Once the bulb is out of the eye, then we can reflange the same lens. And then, but again, reconfirmation of the signs of the bovi at this point is again important to avoid loss or either loss of haptic in such cases. So this can be utilized as a rescue technique, as a reflanging technique, and it becomes very stable after this. As you can see, postoperatively, with initially preoperative, we cannot see any haptic within the scleral tunnel, and after the surgery we can see those haptic which is very well placed. It can also be utilized in rescue of the subluxated three-piece lenses, like in this case had multiple VR surgeries and the phaco was done, but the lens was placed which was three-piece, but it intraoperatively it was stable, but postoperatively it is seen to have subluxated now. So the lens can be migrated back into the anterior chamber by dialing it back, where the haptics can be easily seen and arranged in the way how we want, and marking the site of the sclerotomies where we want to make. As we had discussed, again, the needle is passed 2 mm from the limbus with a 1 or 2 mm of scleral tunnel. using a forceps, the leading haptic can be pushed into the needle and then it can be exteriorized, and then the procedure is more so the same, causing a bovie and then reconfirmation of the size of the bovie and pushing it into the scleral cavity, and the same thing is repeated in the other side. And as we can see, this kind of procedure can be very easily performed in a closed chamber, and it does not have any complications as such associated with it. Again, the bovie is done and the IOL can be very well centered after this. As we can see, this is pre-surgery and post-surgery, IOL is very well centered. So what are the tips of Yamane technique? First, most important, choose a three-piece IOL. As we had discussed earlier, it can be Technis, it can be Kova. Use a 26 gauge needle or a wide 30 gauge needle if it is available. It's a little costly to get it. And most importantly, make a tunnel 2 millimeter from the limbus and a small scleral tunnel 1 or 2 millimeter. And the leading haptic can be railroaded while directly injecting or after the injection into the AC. And the trailing haptic, most important, it can be either the needle can be exteriorized through the port and through the section, and then the haptic can be docked into it, or internal manipulation using a forceps and the edge of the lens can be done. Flange thickness always have to be compared with the external needle thickness, whichever we use. And yes, reflanging or fixation is very easy if it is required. So take home message, Yamane technique has some differences, which they had utilized a wider 30 gauge needle. We has utilized a very commonly available 26 and 27 gauge needle. Simultaneous externalization was done and then cautery was done. In our modification, we flange it first and the leading and the trailing haptics to avoid the resubluxation into the vitreous cavity. And stabilization was used a needle hub. In this case, we had utilized flanging as we had discussed earlier. Trailing haptic, usually in this case, an internal manipulation was done by Yamane, and our modification is either external or you can use the same internalization technique. Thank you. Thank you again.
Nice. Yeah, thank you. Thank you, sir. It was indeed a pleasure being in this group of all inter-segment surgeons. Yeah. If there are any doubts, yeah, I am here, sir.
Yeah, Dr. Divyansh, what should be the size of flange that you are going to create? Is a little, I mean, you said you should compare with the bore of the needle that you're going to use, isn't
yes,
it? Sir. So it will be a little thicker than the bore. That's what.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes. So usually once I flange it, I, as in all my presentations, I show that I try to see that whether the edges are seen just beyond the external diameter of the needle. Because many a times it has happened, I have over flanged or under flanged. If it is under flanged, it's a complication that the haptic would subluxate when we are maneuvering the trailing haptic. That are the chances. But it can still be salvaged beyond that. If we are over-flanging, we can actually cut it and then re-flange it. That can also be done. So in certain cases where the flange was very sharp or where it was little much more bulbous than what is required, in those cases I have cut the part of the flange, and then if required, we can again use the heat cautery and then increase the size. So that can be done. So the exact size, I'm really not sure, sir.
What should be the, I mean, how much of haptic you're going to?
So I try to do it only 1 millimeter or maximum 2 millimeters. I do not want a big bulb. What I do is when I do it a little bit, then I take the heat cautery and put it on it. So it would be like a screw. So like it would be big and then it would be broad also. So like that. So we are not utilizing a longer length in that way.
We are going to basically flatten the flange.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. The flange. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Yeah, it's a pleasure to be with this meeting, sir.
Okay. Satyamurthy, sir, please.
Yeah. Shall I? Okay. Bye.
Okay. Thank you, sir. I would quit the meeting and then I would join the other meeting, sir. Thank you.
Okay. Please. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Yeah. So here we go about my way of doing a scale fixation. Dr. Divyansh has simplified my task very much. So here is a case of aphakia where there was no capsular support. Very well done anterovitrectomy. So now let's see how we go about it. So here two side ports are made, as you see here, about 2 to 3 o'clock hours from the main entry. And then the entry for the AC maintainer the opposite, diagonally opposite points are marked on the cornea. AC maintenance is in place. Now the main entry of about 3 millimeters, like how we do for phaco, is done. And then pupil is constricted with the pilocarpine because we are going to place the lens in the antechamber first. And a 1.5 to 2 millimeter from the surgical limbus is marked on either side. Basically, you don't have to mark. You can see is have a landmark on the conjunctiva. And then using 25 gauge needle at the trocar and cannula, so at the exactly 1.5 millimeter behind the planned diagonal opposite points, so you can place that. And now a three-piece hydrophobic eyewear. In this case, I have used a sensor lens. I have no financial interest in this particular product. So why you have to place the lens completely in the antechamber? Because that will avoid the necessity of the second surgical assistant. Okay, so that you can, that we saw in the previous thing also, you can flange the flange one haptic, which is externalized first. And now the cannula is removed using the handshake technique with ILM. These are the ILM forceps. You can pass through easily through the 25 gauge opening, and one haptic is externalized. Same thing is done with the other haptic. So we can use the side ports for this purpose. And again, the haptic is externalized with the help of ILM forceps, which can pass through 25 gauge opening. Once it is done, we all know that 25 gauge openings, we need not cauterize. That's what our VR friends have taught us. So now the rest of the things is same. Using Bovie cautery, you apply cautery to the tip of the haptic and create a flange which doesn't slip through 25 gauge opening. Now just you have to pass it, and that is the end of it. AC maintenance is removed after that. Now this is the final surgery. See why I did this, because a couple of cases I was not able to pass the trailing haptic into the 26 gauge needle. So then I thought, why not use the Rexis forceps? ILM forceps, like we used to do earlier. Now this is another case where previously done a scleral fixated IOL, it got decentered because of biodegradation of the material. And now here vitrectomy is going on. To this particular video, I have taken from my VR colleague, Dr. Guru Prasad. So what he has done here is he has removed the remnants of this previous suture. Now a side port is created here using VLANs. And now with the 26 gauge needle, which passes about 1.5 millimeters from the surgical limbus, a 7 gauge proline suture, a free suture, is passed through this. Using this railroad technique, the suture is brought out here, as you see here. And now, so that this suture doesn't go back into the vitreous cavity, a flange is created. Now, this particular suture, this is the proximal end, is taken into the vitreous cavity. And now, using the ILM forceps, you just pass through the eyelet of the previous SFIOL, and then pass the suture through this and then bring it out. Dr. Ravi, my screen is seen.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Perfect.
So now, once you bring this out, you can cauterize with the Bovie cautery, and then that is so that it doesn't pass through the eyelet, and now pull it inside. Now you can see the eyeball is already well centered. So now you can cut the remaining part of this proline suture and then apply cautery. Depending upon the amount of resting that you require, you can titrate the flange that you can create, and then so that's the end of it. No, same thing. Actually, Dr. Sri Ganesh and others have shown this earlier. This is called dumbbell technique, which we can use in regular cases. But the only thing is you'll have to use single piece IOLs. So these are my two preferred techniques for skeletal fixation at the moment. Thank you very much for your patient listening.
Nice. Sir, how that bovie cautery is sterilized, sir? ETO?
ETO sterilization, yes.
It has a battery, sir, inside?
Yes, the cells are kept outside. Only thing is, like earlier we used to use this particular cautery, you know, before we got this underwater diathermy. So where the cells are put by the assistant, I mean the floating assistant. But rest of the things is sterilized. Yeah, thank you very much.
Your technique looks very simple, sir, but I am sure it is not that simple. But doing inside that vitreous cavity and
Gold video, not mine, Dr. Guru Prasad's, but it can be done. I mean, it's, yeah.
Thank you very much. Srini, sir, your presentation.
It's there. Can they present it from there?
Yes, sir. Lakshmi.
Good afternoon. Thank you, Ilan and Karnataka Ophthalmic Society for giving me this opportunity. There are several surgical techniques available for the management of FAKIA with no capsula support at all. This includes angle-fixated anterior chamber intraocular lens, iris fixation of iris scleral lens either to the anterior posterior surface of the iris or spherical fixation of the IOL, suture, glued, Yamane, all these techniques are there. But the surgical technique that I prefer the most is the fixation of iris scleral lens onto the posterior surface of the iris. The lens that I use is from XL Optics Chennai. No financial interest at all in this company or the product. And this all-PMM lens has an optic diameter of 5.5 millimeter. Two models are there. One with overall diameter 9 millimeter, the other with 8 millimeter. The haptics have a split at the center, forming a claw into which iris tissue can be trapped. The surgery is done through a scleral tunnel. Two side ports are made, 90 degrees from the scleral tunnel. The first side port being made. The second side port is made diametrically opposite to the first side port, 90 degrees from the scleral tunnel. Pupil is constricted with pilocarpine. And OVD is injected into the anterior chamber. Sodium hyaluronate helon is preferred. The wound is extended to implant the all PMM lens. The IOL is initially placed on the anterior surface of the iris. And the IOL is rotated so that the haptics are oriented to the side pose that we have already made. Then you hold the optic and tilt the IOL in such a way that the haptic goes under the iris through the pupil, and then you lift it up so that it causes a tenting of the iris. Then using a straight rod introduced to the side port on that side, you push the iris down onto the haptic claw so that the iris goes into the haptic claw. And iris tissue is trapped in that haptic claw. So this fixates the iris claw lens onto the posterior surface of the iris at one point. Now you interchange the hands for the instruments. Again, hold the optic, then tilt the IOL again in such a way that it goes under the iris through the pupil. Then you lift it up so that the iris is tended up. Then introduce the straight rod through the side port on that side. And push the iris tissue down onto the haptic claw. If you're not sure that enough iris tissue has been trapped, you can push down again. Now, this has fixated the intraocular lens onto the posterior surface of the iris. You could see that it's very stable. The visco is washed out. And now you can see a well-centered intraocular lens with a round pupil. See, that was an IOL model with the overall diameter 8 millimeter. This is the IOL model with the overall diameter 9 millimeter. And see, I don't remove whatever capsular remnants that are there in that particular case, whichever case is there, because it helps to avoid that pseudophacoidernosis that you see with iris scleral lenses. But the problem with this larger diameter IOL is that frequently you get a mal-shaped pupil. So this never used to happen when I was working with the So I started with this, the small overall diameter 7.25 millimeter, optic diameter 5.25 millimeter iris crawl lens. Always 100% you should get a round pupil. Even with the overall diameter 8 millimeter, it's not guaranteed that you get a round pupil, but that's better than the 9 millimeter. This is a cataract which is subluxated into the anterior chamber, and you remove the cataract, and there is no capsular support at all here. So primary posterior iris fixation of iris crawl lens is being done. So I'll show another situation where iris crawl lens is being used. See here, see the IOL, CTR, everything is in the back. But the IOL CTR back complex is progressively getting dislocated because of pseudo exfoliation. So the whole complex is being taken out. Now the CTR is being taken out, and anterior vitrectomy is done, and the iris crawl lens is being implanted. You can see the iris tissue being pushed down. See, it was pushed down 2-3 times to make sure that enough iris tissue is enclavated. Now, this side also 2-3 times it's pushed on. It's okay. You can push it, but most of the time it works with just one push on. Here again, a well fixated intraocular lens. See, I've done about 1,000 or more of posterior iris fixation of iris crawl lenses. And in my initial one, I think two cases, I had a disenclavation of one of the haptics, but I could manage these cases, re-enclavated properly. But that happened because not enough iris tissue was enclavated. Here, again, see, it is well attached here. In the second haptic, the disenclavated haptic, not enough iris tissue was there. So manipulating the optic and the second haptic can easily bring up the IOL and re-enclavate. See, this is possible unless the initial surgeon has acted, was violent and caused damage to the haptic. So you, it's a very excellent technique. So as I said, I always make sure that whatever capsular remnants are there, stay back to prevent pseudophakic adenoiditis that you very frequently see with posterior iris fixation of intraocular lens. See, these iris crawl lenses have been there for a long time. They have attracted a lot of debates and controversies, but with improved design and surgical technique, we're getting excellent results with iris crawl lenses. Well-centered intraocular lens, very stable intraocular lens, very fast surgery, very short learning curve. Everyone can do it. All anterior segment surgeons can do it. And this is a definite alternative to skilled fixation of intraocular lenses in eyes with no capsular support at all. I once again thank Dr. Elan and Karnataka Ophthalmic Society for giving me this wonderful opportunity. Thank you.
Sir, my question is, what about the patients who need a posterior segment manual procedures like a laser or vitrectomy? How much dilatation it will be there?
Full dilatation. Full dilatation.
Full dilatation.
No issues with dilatation. The only issue that you see is this. You see the pseudophakoadenosis, but it doesn't affect the vision at all. But you can see that tremulating. But otherwise, it's quite good. Like this XL optic design is by J.K. Reddy, my guru. So he was the one who actually really popularized this thing. So he had planned that 9 mm overall diameter initially. Then I said, see, I was getting that irregular people. And I said, sir, why don't we make it smaller? So that is how the 8 mm one came. And one more tip is that even if it is a fully vitrectomized eye, do a PI. Secondary, you're planning, do a YAC PI. Because, see, I told this to JK sir initially. He said, you don't need it. It's vitrectomized and all. Then during one live presentation, he was doing the live surgery. He said, sometimes you learn from your students. Srini told PI is required. Because, see, most of the times it doesn't cause, but sometimes you get the intractable glaucoma, probably because of the pupillary block, even with that flavitectomized eye. So it's you should do a PI in these cases. And the only issue is you might not get such a round pupil, but most of it's round enough. But unlike scleral fixation, you might not get that round. But otherwise, it's excellent. I've done quite a few because niche, I was the one who started, because with JK, I started propagating in Kerala. I used to get a lot of referrals and a lot of other FAKs to manage. So it worked quite well. So I'm not, I've done very few scleral fixations. And my retinal surgeon, Dr. Prakash in Calicut, has shifted from scleral fixation to iris drawing. Yeah, it's so simple. So scleral fixation probably is a gold standard, but this is also excellent.
That's right. Very nice presentation. In fact, very, very good videos. Now, I just want to know from you your experience in children, pediatric FAKs. Can we use this?
I had one case and I talked to people in LB Prasad and they said, no, why don't you go ahead? But I've not done. But Dr. JK had a presentation in American Academy on, he had a series of pediatric cases in which he did iris claw lenses, and all those kids are doing quite well. So he has presented it in Academy. So I am not personally done. I'm not personally.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Sir, Umesh sir is there?
I don't find Umesh here.
I think Jyoti, he has sent a video. Okay. Management of crowded anterior segment during surgery. Ravi Krishna, I think we are well ahead of the timing given for us.
Yeah, good. I reduce the duration of my video from 12 to 6 so that I saw so many presentations. But this is good session. Excellent. I learned a lot.
Anything else, sir?
No, actually, Dr. Srini, I was under the impression that this pupil, that oblong pupil, no, you get only because the inclination is done closer to the pupillary margin, not exactly at the mid-periphery of the iris. But today I came to know with your presentation that it is the smaller level which gives the round pupil.
It used to be so good, sir. But the problem is it's only 4.25 millimeter. It's actually because, see, you actually, it's sort of a blind procedure, right? You're pushing it. Then you might actually pull a bit more of iris towards the side port. That is what is actually causing it. So you push it exactly down, then it works. Around people, but sometimes on table you get scared when you get that real round pupil. On table it might be a good idea to have a small irregular, then you know, okay, it is really inclinated. When you get the real round pupil, then you keep pressing, hey, is it really fixated? So that's it. But it's good, sir.
In case if you want to re-enclavate.
Re-enclavation, I've done a few. If both are down, then I need a vitreoretinal surgeon. So you manipulate, it's like, it won't be going like this. See, it will be somewhere here because the iris tissue is there. So you manipulate that part of the iris, just push it, it comes up. Most of the, you manipulate it a few times, it just comes up. That's what was done in that the video that I showed. Finally, the manipulation was not so good. There was an irregular pupil in there, but manipulate, it comes up. It comes up and then you can manage, unless the haptic is broken. If one haptic is broken, then it is extremely difficult. You have one enclavated, the other one, it's extremely difficult to release it from the iris. You want to release it from the iris, it's very difficult.
You have to go from reverse.
That's a lot of manipulation, but it's difficult. You can manage, but it's extremely difficult.
Dr. Ravi,
what instrument you are using to enclave that 27 gauge cannula?
To enclave it. So what I do is break out the tip of that Sinsky hook. You get Sinsky is there, na? Yes, so you break off the tip of it. Okay. JK has tried cannulas and all, but this works. Some of those thinner ones, Sinsky use. Break the tip and then that is what I use. JK and other people use cannulas and different things. Some surgeons use, I use it alternatively, but mostly I use a lens holding forceps. So whatever. It's you develop your technique and do it, but it's for me to say that's it.
That's about it, sir. You are telling something.
No, that's right. I mean, your experience of doing a disenclavation.
No, sir, I have not done many. I still go ahead with fixation because that iris, lens holding forceps, what I use, I had a tilt once, and once I had one enclaved and one went down. So, 2-3 such bad events, so I went back to clear fixation. Now I am very much inspired by each video. I think we should practice. It's very simple.
Yeah.
It's not simple, but we should try.
Iris enclavation is definitely easier and faster procedure. So, once you, as he said, once you get used to it, probably you'll not go back to other procedures because it's just faster and then easier. So, that's a good thing. Okay.
Probably still the gold standard is scleral fixation. For me and for my retinal surgeons also, they are very high volume retinal surgeons. Have actually shifted to.
I really don't know whether there's a good procedure or not because it is a laborious thing. It may take 10 minutes, it may take half an hour, it may take 1.5 hours also. And second thing is the suture, in case if you are going to suture the thing. Polypropylene is a biodegradable material. After say 5 years, and even though we call it a semi-permanent, it'll after 5 years, 7 years, we have seen the people coming back with the dislocated IOLs. Okay, and the intrascleral fixation, no doubt, is better, but you'll have to. That's what it's a laborious procedure. It looks very nice, especially in edited videos, but.
But there are now sessions on in international conference managing complications of MRI. so that's it. It's a evolving.
Ravi, thank you very much. And I would like to take this opportunity to thank Dr. Jayan Kumaran, my friend, for giving me this opportunity to participate in this. So thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Jyoti, I think we'll end because those two speakers are not there, no?
Okay, doctor.
Okay, thank you, sir. Thank you, Srini, sir. Thank you very much.